Hello friends, welcome to this session of trophoblastic disorder part 2. As we have covered the benign aspect of the trophoblastic disorder in part 1, we will be covering the neoplastic or the malignant aspect of the gestational disorder in this video. So coming to the term GTN, again, the term is self-explanatory. G for the gestational, T for the trophoblastic disorder, and N for the neoplastic condition. Essential, the features of the neoplasia has to be there. So, as I have told in the earlier class, what is a GTN? GTN is simply a trophoblastic disorder which requires chemotherapy for its management is the GTN. It is very simple to speak that which requires chemotherapy. But for a prospective point of view, to which category of the patients will level as this is a case of GTN. So let us discuss who are the candidates for the GTN. The figure has given a very beautiful criteria for the diagnosis. One, this molar pregnancy or the GTD who have been evacuated, who are under follow-up, if they have the beta HCG level, were found to be in 3 weeks, 1, 2, 3. In 3 weeks of the time, the four values are plateau, not decreasing, remaining plus minus 10% value. The curve is maintaining for the 3 weeks in four values. Number two, in 2 weeks of the time, the three values are increasing more than 10%. Number two criteria. Number three, this is for the follow-up of the molar pregnancy. Number three, not necessary a patient will come after the molar pregnancy. Number three, if there is evidence of the abnormal bleeding, we have went for the curettage and the curettage material found to be histologically proven for the GTN, that is either the choriocarcinoma or its different variants that we will discuss. Number four, anything after molar pregnancy. So after molar pregnancy, if after 6 months the HCG level is positive, then those are the candidates that qualify for the GTN, and we stumped it. It is a case of gestational, trophoblastic, neoplasia, and it needs management of that kind. Always I used to give emphasis to the basics of any topic. Basic understanding will strengthen us for the understanding of its clinical features, understanding of its follow-up and everything. So coming to the basic understanding of this GTN, the basic understanding is, I have told that after the normal pregnancy event, after the abnormal pregnancy event, so these are, they will give rise to the, one is and here these are the five variants. After the normal pregnancy, the placental site trophoblastic tumor. Another variant is epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. After the abnormal pregnancy event, persistent gestational trophoblastic tumor or neoplasia, invasive mole if it is localized, and this or this can go into a separate entity, that is what is called as choroidal carcinoma, about which we will discuss in details because most of the cases are of this variant choroidocarcinoma. In nutshell, we will discuss these things, and in vividly we will discuss in this choroidocarcinoma. Coming to the PSTT and the epithelioid tumor, to understand these tumors, we have to go to the basics of the implantation actually. This is a boring topic, again and again I am going to that topic for basic understanding and never to mug up the things. We have to clearly understand what is a trophoblast, what is a sensitive trophoblast, what is a cytotrophoblast, all these things. So, as we know, from the single cell, two cells, then four cells, then morula, then blastocyst, then this blastocyst at the division of the cells, the peripheral trophoblast and inner embryoblast. This trophoblast, I am cutting this portion, which is destined for the implantation coming into the contact with the decidua. This is the decidua and this is the portion of the trophoblast which is destined for the implantation, and this part is called the chorion frondosum. And the rest of the part is called the chorion levae. Chorion levae. This chorion protosome is destined for the implantation, and this is the fetal contribution for the placenta or the trophoblast. Elements arises mostly out of this, different differentiation occurs out of this, then the projection all throughout came from this blastocyst before implantation or during the time of the implantation, but those trophoblasts which are leading to the decidua, they will liberate the enzymes which will dissolve and they will penetrate through the stroma, and this will differentiate, this trophoblast will differentiate and it will form the what is called the primary villi. This primary villi is basically a bunch of cytotrophoblastic cells inside and the sensitive trophoblastic cells outside. These cytotrophoblasts are the mother cells. These are the stem cells of this trophoblast. From this cytotrophoblast, the different cells originates, and this sensitive trophoblast is nothing but the conglomerations of the few cytotrophoblasts, and that's why a sensitive trophoblast is multinucleated. And it has the capacity to secrete what is called the HCG, but the cytotrophoblast is only the role of which is it produces the cells, and these cells ultimately goes to differentiate into the what is called as intermediate trophoblast. From the cytotrophoblast, so the cytotrophoblast or the stem cells or the mother cells, from which the intermediate trophoblast arises, and due to the conglomeration of the cytotrophoblast, an outside sensitive trophoblast is formed. I am just enlarging the view. So ultimately, this is the structure of the villi. Inside, the cytotrophoblasts are there. and outside two is the intermediate trophoblasts are there, and outside to which the syncytial trophoblasts are there. These cytotrophoblasts are of different types depending on its nature. This is the basics I am telling, maybe boring sometimes, but essentially if you can understand these things, it will be very interesting. These cytotrophoblasts are different types. One is, there are two lineages of the cells. One is fusion lineage. So different cytotrophoblasts, they fuse together to form this syncytial trophoblast. Second is invasive lineage. Here the function is the invasion. The fusion lineage, they come out and they fuse together to form the syncytial trophoblast. The invasive lineage is the function to invade into the tissue. They go on invading this decidua. The decidua compactor. Then around, after invading to around 2/3 of the compact layer of the decidua, then decidua spongiosa, then the basal layer is there in the decidua, then myometrium. But after 2/3 of the compact layer, the division nature of these cytotrophoblasts is seized, and invasive nature of the cytotrophoblast is also seized. In this cytotrophoblast, there are two lineages again, two types of the cells. One is interstitial cells, which invades, go on invading. They have the power of invading into the different layers of the decidua, sometimes different layers of the myometrium. And another type of the cytotrophoblast is called the endovascular cytotrophoblast. They invades to the spinal artery of the maternal side, they perforate the maternal artery, then this is one villus, and this is side by another villus. So this is spiral. This is the endovascular cytotrophoblast. So when it invades to the spiral artery, the maternal blood vessel is punctured, and the blood supply or the blood pour into this space that is called the intervillous space. In between the two villus is the intervillous space. And then the blood comes here, and by the time if this villus develops the secondary nature due to the invasion of the mesenchyma, then proliferation of the blood vessels that become the tertiary villi, and the blood vessels here goes and forms here the blood vessels, the artery, spiral artery, then vein. This is the, suppose this is artery, then vein. This becomes the maternal circulation. This becomes the fetal circulation. It forms a placental barrier between the two vascular systems, and the mature placenta is formed. Our discussion is that, what is the problem in the PSTD, placental side trophoblastic region? In PSTD, what happens, this intermediate trophoblasts, if we talk of the intermediate trophoblasts, these are again of the three types. Suppose this is the blastocyst, this is the implantation trophoblast, the rest of the trophoblast, it forms the corion frondosome, the rest forms the corion levi, and the trophoblast which are present in this part is called the chorionic trophoblast, chorionic intermediate trophoblast. The intermediate trophoblasts which are present here, to anchor the primary valence are called the villous intermediate trophoblast. And the trophoblasts which are present at the forefront in the implantation site, those are called the implantation trophoblasts. This is necessary for the postgraduate MCH and also the practitioners to understand the PSTT. The PSTT or the placental site trophoblast occurs from this implantation site trophoblasts, intermediate trophoblast of the implantation site. The intermediate trophoblast present in the implantation sites, they give rise to the placental site trophoblast tint. The intermediate trophoblasts which are present in this part of the corium, in the corium levi, they gives rise to what is called the NTT, ETT or epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. How they differentiate? The PSTT is more malignant in nature, they have more capacity to invade and they are more aggressive form. Epithelioid trophoblastic tumor are relatively benign in nature, and there forms some mucin-like materials around a single blood vessels. There is presence of the necrosis. It gives a geographical pattern, and sometimes it gets the histopathological features. It confused with the squamous cell of the cervix, squamous cell carcinoma of the cervix, because the SCC is differentiated from the by the presence of the typical presence of the pearl pattern, and in the ETT there is lack of the pearl pattern. This is the difference in the histopathology. So this is in nutshell. So this intermediate trophoblast does not secrete HCG, human corionogonadotropin. They secrete instead human somatotropin, somatomammotropin, or the human placental lactogen. And these intermediate trophoblasts, they doesn't respond to the what is the conventional chemotherapy, and when it occurs, the therapy is the hysterectomy, unfortunately. They can be diagnosed. How they can be diagnosed? After a normal pregnancy event, termination of the normal pregnancy event, if beyond 8 weeks, if there is abnormal bleeding continuing, and the ultrasonography is showing some growth inside, then there is possibility that these may be two variants, and of course the ultrasound showing vascular pattern of the growth, then in contrast to the RPOC, RPOC will not show the vascular pattern in the Doppler. In contrast, the PSTT or the ETT will show the vascular pattern. If the vascular pattern is there beyond 8 weeks of the termination pregnancy, patient is complaining, I am having the abnormal bleeding, then you can go for the estimation of the HPL, you can go for the biopsy very carefully, and by that way we can establish that this is a case of the PSTT or the ETT. If it comes, then the treatment is the hysterectomy. This is regarding the events that occurred after the normal pregnancy event. Something then, the persistent gestational trophoblastic tumor. As I have told, the diagnosis is by the curve. I mentioned that if the HCG is not falling, it's a plateau for the 3 weeks with over 4 estimation of the HCG, or it is increasing activity over the span of the 2 weeks, last 2 weeks, or it was decreasing, then increasing, or remaining plateau, it suggests the activity of this in situ trophoblast is there, and the diagnosis is PGTT. No need of going for the biopsy. From the serum HCG only, we will stop that. The first diagnosis it is a persistent gestational tumor and it qualifies for the GTN and will go for the chemotherapy. Here the basic problem for this discussion, here the basic problem is that this cytotoxoplast, which loses its division capacity after reaching to a certain extent by the action of the two agent, one is TGF beta and another is decodin. These are the two agents or the two chemicals or the things that inhibits the division or the power of divisions of the cytotoxoplast. Thereby, the division, mitotic division, ceases after a certain point of time. But this is absent in case of PGTT. That's why the trophoblast start of the continued divisions of the PGTT is found, and ultimately we found a persistent type of the tumors. Then another variety is the invasive mole. If abnormal bleeding continuing, some HCG events continue, the persistent HCG continues, and the ultrasound shows that, here the ultrasound will show that there is presence of the tumor in the, more often towards the cavity. But here in the ultrasound and the Doppler, it will show the growth to be more towards the muscle layer. There is invasion and there is more activity towards the muscle layer or inside the muscle layer, then that is called the invasive mole. When you will go put the Doppler over it, you will find lot of vascularity over a localized area inside the muscle or the myometrium, then that is called the invasive mole. What is the basis of it? What happens when this cytotoxoplast, the implantation site cytotoxoplast, they have the capacity of the invasion, the invasive lineage that I have told. They used to go on invading to the decidua compactor, then after around more than 2/3 when it pierces the decidua compactor, the further invasion is seized by a membrane, what is called the Nitta-Hook's membrane. If the absence of this Nitta-Hook's membrane is there, and absence of this TGF beta and the decodin is there, the activity of the cytotoxoplast, the division activity of the cytotoxoplast continues, and there is absence of the Nitta-Hook's membrane and other factors, then they start or they continue to invade into the myometrium to form the what is called the invasive mole. This invasive mole, the therapy is again the chemotherapy. We'll go for the chemotherapy and same line of management will continue, we'll discuss. And these two things comes under the local neoplastic disease of the trophoblastic or the trophoblast. Then comes the topic of discussion is the choriocarcinoma. What is the difference between the choriocarcinoma and PGTT? This is of course the HP diagnosis or histopathological diagnosis. The histopathological will show that there is absence of the villous pattern, but there is presence of the both cytotoxoplast and the syncytiotrophoblast, and there is essentially presence of the necrosis. These are the few factors or few things in the pathology. One is absence of the villous pattern, presence of the trophoblast, and presence of the necrosis in the histopathological slide. If with the curettage we are getting these three things, then it is a case of choriocarcinoma. When we come to the clinical scenario, this was the first part of the discussion in the GTN. The second part of the GTN is the clinical scenario, and we may take a break now, then we will come to the second part of the GTN, that is the clinical scenario. By that, you hold your nerves. I'm coming after just 5 minutes. Bye-bye.